So this presentation is on what's going on in Taiwan. It's called the vTaiwan process for building consensus and citizen-led deliberation. I'm Patrick Connolly. This is Alex.
Hello.
And so what is Occupy America and resulted in broad-based consensus that showed government what steps to take? What if the city tech community in our city was asked by the city government to install a whole process for women? So this is happening in Taiwan right now. This specifically was when they took over parliament, but the project came out when they left parliament and the government recognized they were forced to be reckoned with in collaboration with local communities and they had a focus.
Back on?
Yeah, just keep raising your hand if we're not using mics. This is apparently a fine science. Every government and civil society work together on the vTaiwan task force. You can see working here early on. Basically, every Wednesday, groups from the city and government come together to propose issues of deliberation action and to work and reiterate on the process itself. So this is a little bit of context that we're going to first.
This is a little slide here. Real quick, couple of things to touch on because, like, people say this is a good one. Brief modern history. Since the 1990s, democratic reforms in Taiwan after the end of their martial law has been very heavily intertwined with the information revolution. So a lot of their demand for greater civic participation has come along with democracy tools. And as part of that movement, in 2012, the Dog Zero movement, which is kind of like their larger, it doesn't exactly identify as a civic act, but it's the logo that you see in the middle here, that's kind of the spirit that goes on, it's like hands-on, it's public spirited, it's open source, and that's where it strives to be. And the vTaiwan project was basically where the Dog Zero movement started meeting with, have people heard of sunflower movement by any chance in Taiwan? Cool. So imagine Occupy, that was the Occupy slides, the point where Gov Zero met the sunflower movement, there was like this more broad-based demand for more like a participatory tool for public consultation. So that's when this came into play. That's what we're focusing on. In terms of context. So it arose from the media response. So imagine like a hacknight, and this one of the risks of that year. A minister of health portfolio called Jack Pinsani came out with a proposal for it to Gov Zero saying, can you create a platform for rational discussion in relation to policy issues of the entire nation can participate? And this, after like a little while, it resulted in a pilot that went for 3 months at the output that signed into law. And the original pilot for that project was with visual issues. So the issues that they're dealing with are mostly the visual domain, specifically because of many reasons, but they can make it like political support, but also like digital access, and making sure that people are familiar with the tools. And the first one was considering small business. Yeah. So like regulations around allowing people to establish small businesses and refining that process of how can we make it better. That was the project I compiled, the output was what I signed up. So as of February 2018, this 26 crisis has been deliberated. 80% of elected decided for government action. This is taken from their home page. Slight nuance there is not all of it is legislation per se, but in any case, there is something to that in terms of the government having been assigned accountability to take action on the results that came out of the environment. And the issues of including Uber, prevention polling, and things like that. Saying. If you're quite curious about any of these, we can try to find them out.
And
so
a big part of framework that is facilitation. Those who are familiar with facilitation might have heard of it, called the ORI framework, also known as focused conversation method. It's just this way of something kind of layered approach to bringing about the right information. Thanks, John. The right information at the right time, and it takes into account facts, feelings. So it starts off with objectives, so it's also called ORI, it's like an acronym. So it starts off objective, these are basic facts. Kind of think of it as things that we all agree on, the foundation of the later phase of the process will be. And then the reflective phase, the R word, and this is feelings. And these are subjective, they're not supposed to be disputable, so if anyone can kind of put them forward, it's not your place in the process to disagree with how someone's feeling, it's just how they are. Ideally, it's supported by facts, but it doesn't have to be. You don't have to, it's not common to feel certain ways, and there's, you know, it can tease the department to try to put some facts in it, but that might not always be how that comes into the conversation. So the next phase is the interpretive phase. That's basically for ideas. It's where you see, you understand all facts. You know the feelings that are in the landscape among the people who consider themselves stakeholders, and now you're starting to kind of like process those and work through them and think ways forward. So it's kind of, you don't turn down any ideas at this stage. It's kind of like throw everything into the pot, acknowledging facts, feeling good, fine. And then the final phase is the decisional phase. You actually start to figure out, kind of narrow it all down and decide what direction. So that's the framework that underlies a lot of this months-long process every time they run it. So how it works is
this is just a general review. We're just about to walk through it in more detail. Real quick takeaways here: 4 stages: proposal, opinion connection stage, the issue deliberation stage, and the legislation stage. Especially after the proposal, it roughly mirrors the word. Facilitation framework. So that's what you're trying to achieve philosophically by going into the deliberation with that mindset. So for the proposal stage, it's brought into a hackathon, opinion collection. There's a big component where Paco needs to take you into detail, where and this is like a bigger process, where you try to map opinions visually through statements so that people are reacting to components of the issue that have been broken down. It's not something that's been pre-framed for you. It's almost like you're trying to gather sentiments about, how do people feel about this kind of thing. And then based on that emotional landscape, you're bringing together a solution at the deliberation stage, and then the output of that gets funded from the solution when that's available.
This is the big overview. We'll kind of step through it slowly. This is kind of the big thing. The first piece is identifying the issue, and that's kind of like figuring out what kind of doing polls and finding out what do the people who are running this process, the citizens who are running this process, what are they interested in like working with kind of assist in that process. It's kind of what involves like it's important to like make basically the community is involved deciding what they're going to assess from the public. And they qualify if they hone in on exactly what they do things in interesting ways that traditional public consultations don't do. They use Facebook ads and Twitter ads, use targeted advertising to bring people forward based on how they identify these platforms. And that's not normally a way that's not a traditional way that happens. So that's the proposal state. That's very early on. It's the one that facilitates is shaping the language framework for the later discussion.
This part, loosely mirrors what gets written down in a lot of conditional consultation processes. You've got the stakeholders. Something really important here is that stakeholders have been able to very easily, without a lot of resource input, invite other stakeholders that they see mixing into the process along the questionnaires. They're able to identify knowledgeable people. So the pool of participants is allowed to organically grow in that sense. Those are the main things at this stage. Next stage.
After you've kind of done the invites, reached out to people, you allow guests to come in, then you start kind of building a body of facilitators, and the participants who are starting to arrive start to like build a body of terms. These terms are kind of important to define those before getting into a larger, more nuanced discussion, so that they kind of they'll allow everyone to practice first to get into terms. Size, because whoever read legal jargon has the terms can be intimidating on their own, but they can keep them small and digestible, right? This is like a super early phase, and if the terms are like page to find, like things you're talking about that have really alienating people to participate. So they kind of like put constraints on these earlier phases, like small protocols. And they also kind of build collective wikis together.
Ooh, nice.
They build collective, they build a lot of wikis together that the facilitators have built a great scaffold for before folks arrive.
And this part, participants are able to ask questions and I make as usual, like designs and conservation processes. But because, especially since it gets pinned to that proposal stage where the initial, a big part of this process is a competent agency of some sort, the powers and government has to have accepted the accountability for it. So the competent agencies, to all questions that have been asked, have to respond. I think it was like within a week. There's the week response time, and it's possible. I think it's part of my responsibility to make sure that all questions are answered. After the stage, as questions get answered, you have time, you go into the opinion that you see.
Yeah, so like this is technically still like a citizen project, but the cooperation can say, hey, someone from the government will be here to answer the question. It's super powerful. So this phase is the one where so this is called piggybacking, is what we call this. It's kind of the second public phase. Kind of build body facts together in terms. And now you're like, hey, you're kind of talking about feelings, which are, sometimes that's like a process, especially ones that try to be like, evidence-based policy making. They don't necessarily, they might not need a whole lot of space for feeling and emotions, but this kind of recognizes really that whole final decision to shape a heart, like feelings aren't a surprise. So, they use a tool called POLIS, which kind of threw up some visualization. It's kind of important how this works. So you can imagine this is a tool, and when you first arrive, this is what you see. Just say you've, this is a chair review, so you're in a stakeholder group, and so you go and you're invited to share your feelings related to the topic of our discussion. And you come there at the very top, this is just a large version of what's on the side. This is a seat. And it's just kind of basically, ideally they start with I feel, or like I feel speaks. This one doesn't happen to be, but often they are. And you're just going to ask to agree, disagree, or pass. I'm not sure. So you kind of start clicking through this. Maybe not even getting ready to start, but you're just kind of like, oh, what's he? And as you're going and agreeing, disagreeing with these, and new ones are coming up, you're trying to agree, disagree. You see this visualization below. Where there's this special blue dot that's kind of standing out to you, and you see that every time you click agree or disagree, it's moving around a little bit. And maybe once you get to 10 or 12, it's kind of gone into one of these groups, moved from the center to into one of those groups. And you're like, okay, cool, well, like, that's me, and I'm in that block now. And then if you look down below, this is what you start to see. You can like explore that group, say it's group D. And what you would come to realize, when I haven't read any instructions, is that these are, this is actually like, you might not know this, but under the covers, it's like this statistical method that's happening that's grouping in a visual, kind of intuitive way, groups that really disagree together on a lot of feeling statements. So even if maybe no one person, everyone kind of thinks of this is like, hey, this is me and my group and everyone else against me, this kind of reveals where there's like nuance. There's like different groups that share different values. You can kind of like surf through each group and see what statements like binding them together. And so you can kind of actually like, instead of just understanding your own group, you can actually like hop into someone else's like perspective and start looking around and seeing what binds them together. And also if you come across, like if you get to the end of this, agree or disagree with lots, and you still have like, I still feel a certain way and I just need to express that. Into this conversation, you have the chance to add your own statements. And so where this comes into play is that with this, essentially they do this really cool, clever thing with this whole process. What you're doing when you're participating in this sentimental landscape app part, it runs over a couple weeks. You keep visiting this and seeing as new things get added or calls. So you're told that if you can find, I'm going to use this little so you can look through each group, each opinion group, but you can also look at each other. You can actually explore the majority of opinions. And that is the thing is that underneath all your differences, the things that you all agree on together in very high numbers, which often gets lost in mind. You know, if you're in a Twitter conversation arguing about things, it's very rare that you stop and go, whoa, 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 what do we all agree on? Whereas in this tool kind of keeps surfacing. And so what they decided in Taiwan with this process is they say, hey, if over the course of a couple of weeks, if you can find majority opinions, things that you all agree on at that point, maybe that you don't, yeah, you can find things you all agree on. The things that you found, the statements that you found, will get free pass into the, like, the important stakeholder meeting later, and they'll be on the agenda. And all those important people, the government agencies, the like organizations, the union representatives, will have to discuss this point you found as just like a regular person in the public sphere. So people will like think of this, they'll actually like start trying to understand the other groups so that they can like maybe drop a statement here. Like maybe I'm here, but I want to get a majority of them, so I want to really understand this group and know what motivates them. And I'm gonna try to find something in between us so that I can get what I want. So it just makes this interesting, like building a theory of mind around like what groups who are not your own are thinking. I'll stop. So the next phase is where that agenda, like together you set the agenda here. We call it set the agenda, and then that comes into play in this portion.
Yeah, and as you can see, all this is going on. Now we're at the part where we have a stakeholders meeting. So there's a physical space where the events actually occur and the stakeholders are interacting. There's technical expertise being provided. But a big distinction to make here also is the traditional policy processes. You see that, you know, like a lot of the technical experts frame the issue and they already have, in a way, a certain kind of solution that's what's given the feedback on. But at that point, it's really difficult to suss out where people are objecting or where people have different kinds of opinions. So that's the phase where we start to see with the opinions that we're working with. At the stakeholders meeting, the technical expertise is being fed, but they're not over-determining the results that come out. And as the physical event is going on, it's all being live streamed, and the participants that are interacting with everything that's happening online are also asking questions. There is basically a room full of facilitators that are relaying the online discussions and questions to the process as well. So that's what you can see it over here, the stakeholders meeting. Once these are actually going to be fed. So you have scholars, facilitators. There's actually a room set up that I can speak to real quick.
Yeah, so basically, this really intentional about the layout of the room is the stakeholder meeting. It's really important. They live stream it, they have like group involvement. They have like essentially a little like command center corner. It's not here, but they have basically there's like three people kind of manning and pulling in feedback from the outside watchers and actually asking to the moderator, surfacing things across. So they're really engaging, even though like people in the room have a lot of power, they go make a lot of effort to create a way to like bring in outside perspectives. They're kind of very intentional about where people are sitting in the semicircle where the representatives are, and they actually kind of like called a lot of these representatives from earlier in the process, people who service. Maybe they like logged into Opus with their like organization Twitter account and like contributed really positively. The people who show up here are not the ones who perhaps imagine when they first started the group so they're like their agenda, they have a lot of printing, there's like fan station for they essentially run on Twitch, which is like a gaming platform with major interaction. And then they actually transcribe it, like they live transcribe it, people sitting on the side who are like rapidly typing everything that's said. And at the end they kind of bring this, they have tools to like pull this into like transcription tools so that this becomes like each little thing that's said and applicable in news stories and on social media. So it becomes very shareable.
Some aspects of the outcome may then legislation. What really becomes what just happened is kind of like, you know, like there's a lot of other stuff that's involved here. But ultimately, the whole point is they've been through this entire process, which is hyper accountable, hyper transparent, and ultimately, the government is because they accepted in the first place, they are held to the responsibility to do something about it. And a lot of the time it does result in some legislation around the process.
So just to tie all this together before we wrap up, this is they have together built content and together they invited a bunch of everyone in, the stakeholders in, the state by more stakeholders, they defined terms, created content, had a formal discussion, people have set the agenda in a way that involves surfacing all the feelings that they're bringing into this. They feel like those are acknowledged and part of the process. And then the agenda that's set is used to lead a conversation among like kind of more expert stakeholders. All of that ends up transposed, walked into timestamps and videos and say, then at the end they build specification, like it's kind of a description of what they want the law, and everything points back to faces. They point to the timestamps, they point to like places in the transcript, like it's all backed up by the data that everyone's looked together during this. And they ask the politicians to write the legislation to the specification. So it's all like ties together, real nice. Reflections. Real quick, just as it goes through the phases, there's high participation at the beginning, but then as it gets to later phases, there's less participation directly, but more power for people who are like, say, sitting in the room or writing specification. And that's a move kind of generally through the order process as the weeks long thing is on.
And again, real quick wrap up to some of these slides. The really cool aspects about this process, it scales participation, traditional policy processes, and what people you try to reach, it does require you to compromise in terms of time and resources at some point, and it's like a stop point to develop this process. You can invite more and more people. You might have to increase the time that you run the processes for it for like a little bit, but it won't, you know, intensively increase the amount of time and resources that you pour into the process itself. There's transparency built into the design, as we see throughout it, you know, accountability, timestamps, attachment, you say, it's all transcribed, live streamed, people with questions, get their questions answered. Citizens also, I think that this is a really exciting thing, that in the process of consultation, the citizens are, you know, they're the ones that are getting the agenda, at least set the agenda for the legislation that comes out, or like results that emerge. And also just in terms of food for thought, I think it's important to consider how central, you know, as we're going through this process, we're not just jumping from tool to tool. We're like, it's human, it's facilitated by humans. So ultimately, like, this is a technology-assisted way of navigating the spaces between the institutions that, you know, like overlook a lot of our activities, and also other profiles and individuals. But the centrality of how important like, the humans and like human communication is to that process, I think, is information. Further considerations, just you know, barriers, primary dependencies, or right out of time, some local communities, but these are some things to think about as we go forward.
Okay. That's it. I mean, you know, we're not doing this time. So thanks for listening. We're here, please do ask if you have any questions.
Thanks, guys.